Please come.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon.
Please have a seat.
Yes, sir.
So, Dr. Prassannakumar.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
You know the condition of India. India is a progressive country.
Definitely, sir.
But at the same time, you know the health conditions of women, particularly the rural women, malnutrition, mortality rate, incidence of other diseases, all this.
Yes, sir.
You spent money, you did all that, became a doctor.
Yes, sir.
But you want to serve the people, but you are not interested in serving the people. You want to go there and you can help so many people, which is the need of the hour, and that you are running away, and then you want to become a bureaucrat, which is known well for red tapeism, delay, corruption. Why?
Sir, I think it's the other way around, sir, because as a doctor, at one point of time, I can just treat one patient, sir, but here, I'll be in a capacity where I can really work on the preventive aspect of health, because health is not an individual term by itself, sir, because it has other dimensions like poverty, as you said, nutrition, awareness. In all these aspects, as a civil servant, I'll be capable of delivering much better to the rural India as well as the Indian society, sir. So that is why I chose this field. And moreover, according to me, prevention is better than cure, sir. And it's definitely, is that so, like, I think I'll be in a better position to serve from the civil servant aspect, sir.
Really? But what makes you think that you can make a difference when hundreds of all others like you have, with the same ideas, have gone into the IAS? And if they had done what you think they had done, today you wouldn't be having such a, you know, health indices and things like that. So if they have not been able to do it, either they have not been able to do or they are not willing to do, so what makes you feel that you can go and change the whole system?
Sir, in my opinion, I think they have been doing their best till now, because that is why when we take the 1947 indices, our death rate was almost like 30 to 31%, like 31 per thousand. And right now the death rate is just 7.3. But I'm not saying that it has completely improved. We still have scope for it. And I can take some examples like Dr. Samit Sharma, who was the pioneer of introducing generic medicine in the whole state of Rajasthan. He was a doctor come an IAS officer. So I think people have contributed it. And I would also love to do the same, sir, because there is still a lot of scope left, sir. And I am very confident that I'll be able to do it, sir.
Sir, tell me, what are the internal and external security threats India is facing at this moment?
Sir, to answer to the first part of the question, regarding the internal threat, so the major internal threats which India is facing is the problem of separatism in Jammu and Kashmir. And in the southern states, in the middle and the southern states, we have the problem of left-wing extremism.
Ooh.
And in the northeastern states, we have the problem of excess migration and problem of the sense of soil theories, which is happening over there. And in the western borders, we have the problem of infiltration, across cross-border infiltration and drug smuggling, sir. And coming to the second part of the question regarding the external threats which India is facing, one major problem is cross-border terrorism, sir, which is a major threat India is facing, sir. And apart from that, we are also facing major problems in case of economic threats, like round-tripping of money and all these hawala transactions, which is actually threatening the security of India, sir.
So if, let's say, for example, if you use your credit card,
yes, sir.
If you draw money,
yes, sir.
Okay, you'll have to pay interest. For that, whatever the money.
Yes,
but I use the credit card to put money into Paytm.
Yes.
And take that Paytm, transfer it back to my account.
Yes.
Is it called round tripping?
Sir, that is not round tripping, because it is what Paytm is offering. It's the market strategy.
No, I'm cheating, no. Basically, what I should have paid interest,
yes,
now I'm avoiding paying that thing. I'm taking the money out of my account, I'm putting it back into my account,
yes,
and making it interest free, and I can use it.
Sir, that interest is borne by the company of Paytm, sir, because Paytm will be paying the interest to your bank. So, because that is the business strategy of Paytm, where they try to attract people first into their hub, sir. So, that is a strategy of Paytm, but it is not round tripping, because Paytm will be paying the interest to the respective banks, sir.
Okay. We'll come back to you. Thanks, please.
Dr. Kumar, what would you think a quality of yours as a medical practitioner and a physician would be best aiding you as a civil servant? My next question I'll ask you later after hearing you.
Ma'am, one major quality as a doctor, which I have learned all these years, is decision making, ma'am. Okay. I would just like to quote one example from my own experience.
Right.
It was one Sunday evening where I was the only medical practitioner in my casualty, ma'am.
Right.
And there were like immediately, all of a sudden, within a span of 5 minutes, almost 4 patients came up.
Oh.
So at that time, I didn't know really what to handle. That was the first experience which I had to face such a death or situation, and it was a casualty. All the patients came in an emergency.
Mm-hmm.
But how to attend and how not to, which patient to give the priority, I really faced very, very big difficulty. But at the end of the day, I was very satisfied that I have really done justice on the day, because I just prioritized the patient based on, I was very fast that day, and I was able to stabilize the patients first and then take the definitive care.
Mm-hmm.
I think the same thing can be applicable in civil services, because
mm-hmm.
decision making is one of the major reasons a civil servant should have in their career.
That's right.
That is one thing. And second thing, as a doctor, I think we are exposed to the reality of the society, ma'am, because coming from a government medical college, I've really seen the poorest of the poor and how they suffer, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
And moreover, poverty is something which only we can see and we can experience, ma'am. And I've really seen that, because I've seen families going into poverty just because of their medical reasons.
Mm-hmm.
So those are things which has taught me empathy and sympathy, I feel, which will be very much helpful for my civil service prospectus, ma'am.
Great answer. Thank you. I think as a medical practitioner, you would also agree with me that life by itself is a great value. There is no disagreement on that. For anyone or anybody, life is important.
Definitely.
What is your thinking about the current approaches to euthanasia? And okay, maybe I'll stop there. Yeah. What do you think about decision, particularly when you talk about decision making? You know, I don't know if you were aware of this case, but this couple, I'm unable to remember their country. The child, in about third month of her birth, the child showed complete dysfunction of the entire bodily organ. And the only thing is, you just end its life, and completely supported by artificial machinery. And so the court apparently said that the child has to be, you know, taken off. But the parents fought the case, and finally, I think they lost the case.
Yes.
What is your approach in understanding life by itself, and how do we value life? And when it comes to life and legalizing legal approaches and views about life, it becomes an extremely complex matter, because people's emotions are involved. So as a physician, again, who is going to be making major decisions, perhaps in a much larger scale, in a much societal, larger societal space? What is your thinking about euthanasia?
Ma'am, according as you already said, life is very precious, ma'am. And one thing I would like to say as a physician is that we are definitely not the final authority to say what is life, when it will end. We are definitely not, ma'am, because
right.
in my own experience also, I have seen patients, we thought the patient is definitely helpless, he's not going to survive, and I have seen patients who are surviving from that extreme situations also, ma'am. And I don't think any human has that superpower to decide who has to live and who shouldn't live.
Mm-hmm.
So in my opinion, I think passive euthanasia should be allowed, because ultimately, a patient should also be allowed to die with dignity. It is also his right. That's what I feel. And but active euthanasia, I'm kind of against active euthanasia, because, as I said, it's not how we decide, and we will not be able to decide. And second thing is, active euthanasia can be prone to misuse also, ma'am, in future. So we should have very strong legal backing. Like I think 2 or 3 countries like Belgium and Netherlands, which they have already, they are allowing active euthanasia. But I don't think in our own society, active euthanasia will be possible right now.
Well, I have one more question. It's not a question, just trying to understand what your views are about. Today there's a lot of discussion on replacing what we call as life, which is inspired by biological material and replacing it by synthetic material, and we largely call it an artificial intelligence, robotics, and so on. And of course, there are lots of science fiction movies where life itself can be a very networked system instead of just an individual. Here, I don't know, you see the movie Transcendence, which is basically, have you seen that movie?
Yes,
okay, nice. Great. So in that movie, it demonstrates that how life can be so networked, and then you can influence a huge amount of people and systems around. But finally, that movie ends with a sad note, as you know that, right? It's a failure of so-called large amount of life in a networked system. What is your, again, your thought on artificial agents, machine agents, mechanistic agents, robotics taking over life and living in this world which we today see as inhabited by ordinary people like you and me? I say ordinary, of course you can contest that.
Ma'am, I think we are living in a society of scientific revolutions.
Okay.
And revolutions and evolutions are bound to happen in a society, ma'am.
Okay.
In my opinion, we shouldn't stop such evolutions and revolutions because it is actually helping us in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, we have artificial intelligence saving a lot of lives and robotics. For example, we have robotic surgeries which have actually prolonged our human life and all.
Right.
So in such cases, for the benefit of the human, it should be allowed. No?
Yes.
But the problem is, again, anything has an equal and opposite reaction.
Mm-hmm.
We should be stopping that opposite reaction when it falls into the hands of anti-social elements like the terrorism and all. It can be a major threat to humans. And the thing is, we shouldn't be fastly shifting over to artificial intelligence because it needs some studies and it should be allowed in a step-by-step manner because, as you said in the movie also,
mm-hmm.
because of the adoption of technology in a faster manner also can be fatal. So I think society has to evolve by itself and it should be allowed to take that time and evolve, man, because artificial intelligence as such, it's a boon for mankind.
Stop there. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So, Dr. Prassannakumar,
yes,
see, how many years you are working now?
Sir,
doctor, you are practicing doctor?
Sir, right now I'm not practicing, sir. I'm just preparing, sir.
Okay. See, compared to the Western countries, India is concerned, as much we do look for our physical health, but we don't really think about mental health. How do you see this? Physical health, it's always mental.
Sir, I really agree to your statement because the health and definition itself, it's a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
We always take care of the physical part only and it's the reality also. Sir. Because according to recent data, it says that almost 14% of the Indians are facing mental stress. So, which is a huge number, but the problem is, and we have the psychiatrist ratio as 1:10,000, which is very abysmal in nature. So, this shows that we are actually not focusing on the mental health. But one thing I would say that a happy mind can lead to a happy body. Definitely, we should focus on mental health, and I think the concept is growing day by day. And we have the mental health care bill, which is trying to address that also, because when a person is actually, that's what I'm trying to say, that when a person is happy, he will be free of ailments.
I agree with you.
Very, very good. See, this NEET examination is concerned. You know that NEET problem, especially
yes.
Pondicherry was also with the Tamil Nadu,
yes.
But that NEET examination should be only based on the marks.
Yes.
That's fine. But you see, the doctors, when they come out, now government came with a bill that okay, they should work for at least 2 years in the rural.
Definitely, sir.
And India, more than 70% live in rural. Why doctors are opposed to it? But for making a doctor, it's lakhs of rupees spent on it. But why don't they just go for 2 years in a rural job, rural work, and then come back for that? Why are they opposed to it?
Sir, the major reason why they are opposing is that first thing is the career itself is a long career to just get established, sir, because 5.5 years of MBBS with 3 years of specialization, 3 years of super specialization, it takes a long time, sir, and in between you get breaks for preparation and all this. And that is why the main reason that doctors actually oppose. But according to me, as India lives and the welfare of the people is in the rural society, so I think it should be a good move. But one thing I feel is that the government also should try to incentivize the doctors to go and serve in the rural area. Like, for example, I'll take the model of Tamil Nadu, where doctors are given extra benefits for the reservation systems in the postgraduate medical education. And because of that, actually, we don't have any vacancies in Tamil Nadu rural areas, doctors. So I think such kind of measures can be taken. And second thing I feel why doctors are not ready to serve in the rural area is that due to lack of infrastructure, sir. Because at the end of the day, a doctor will be very much contented only when he treats the disease as a whole, sir. If he just treats the symptoms, I don't think that will give satisfaction for the doctor as such. But to treat the disease as a whole.
Fine, you just go ahead. But now the issue is that, see, when you have been given education based on taxpayer money, and then the rural fellow also leaves,
yes,
and you also indirectly paid your tax, your payment.
Definitely, sir.
Okay, there are indirect taxes also, they pay, it's not even tax. Okay, that's supposed to be the duty bound for the doctor to really serve in the rural.
Definitely.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So that's in that context I'm asking.
I completely agree to your statement, but it's a sad state of affairs that doctors are not going. But I think as a doctor, I would personally definitely agree to your argument that doctors should serve in the rural areas.
Did you serve in the rural area?
Because of that only I come here to serve in the civil services. That
I don't know. As a doctor, did you serve?
Sir, but I thought I can contribute in a much larger way. That's why I come here. And once if I get that opportunity, I can attract a lot of doctors to rural areas also, sir.
No, but how do we accept? You see, when you had the opportunity, you didn't go and serve in the rural area. But now, if a different way you want to go and serve.
Sure, I just wanted to serve for the larger cause.
I wanted to come back to you because of a particular word which you used when you responded to me. You talked about health in terms of not only physical health and mental health, you also used well-being, the idea of well-being. What do you think the whole notion of well-being, what does it indicate? What does that mean?
Ma'am, the notion of well-being is that a person should be actually doing well in all the three spheres of life. As I said, mental, physical, and also social well-being, ma'am.
Physical, mental, and social.
And social.
Okay.
But actually, it should not phase. He should feel a part and parcel of the society also.
Exactly.
He should be at peace at the mental level, and he should also be out of ailments in the physical body also. Yeah. That is called as well-being.
Great. It's an interconnectedness.
Definitely.
Right?
Yeah.
Sure.
So, last question. any program, any development, any change. Okay. For example, the doctors start with it, and especially in organ donation. For example, eye donation has become big again and is broad now in the world, which is there. But giving a total body, okay, and people are not coming forward. And still they stick to that, you know, karma, that, you know, be buried and then it should be burnt. How do you see this, whether organ donation, how this will really help people who really need?
Sir, there is no doubt that it is going to help a lot of people, sir, because organ donation is almost equal to providing one more extra life.
Yes.
So the problem is that in our own society, because of prejudicious and superstitious beliefs, we still have some opposition for donating organs. But I think day by day, the organ donation is going up, and government and the civil society should take the responsibility to create awareness by underlining the benefits of organ donation. So that every person comes up and does that. And second thing, what I have noticed is that, first of all, people don't know where to donate organs and how to donate organs itself, sir. So that is also very much lacking in our society. I think if we can address these two issues, organ donation will definitely increase in our India also.
But last 3 years, there was an award given by the Government of India. Continuously, Tamil Nadu is getting that award.
Yes,
sir. It's a pioneer. Tamil Nadu is a pioneer, indeed.
Yes, sir.
So we'll do it.
Definitely, sir.
Dr. Prassannakumar. Dr. Prassannakumar. Recently, past 10-15 days,
yes, sir,
lot of foreign dignitaries have been visiting.
Yes, sir.
You just develop that.
Sir, recently, I'm aware of the president of Iran visiting India. Then we have the visit of the Jordanian king to India. And also 2 days back, we had a business level delegation from South Korea coming to India, sir. So all these three were happening the last 10 to 15 days, sir.
Yes, sir.
about Canada?
I'm
Canada.
I'm sorry, Canada. Sir. I just missed out, sir. I'm really sorry.
And then this...
Today there is a little change.
Today there is one person leaving.
The Canadian, nobody notices because he's so bohemian. You know, he doesn't feel like a...
I'm sorry, sir. I just don't...
Vietnam president.
Vietnam president. He came on second and today he's leaving.
Sorry, sir. Canadian, you could not have missed out because that was the one controversial visit.
Yes.
It generated a lot of publicity, negative publicity,
yes,
which normally does not happen.
Definitely,
what,
sir.
What was that? What are the controls connected with this visit?
Yes, there were two major controversies. One is that he had a very extended visit, like of 7 days, but he had the official level visits on the 7th day only. And it was said that no major dignitaries went and received them also at the airport. And second thing is, in this visiting delegation, one pro-Khalistan leader was also part of the delegation, which created controversy in India, sir.
Okay. How many contracts or pacts were signed with Canada?
What are the major focus?
Major.
Sir, I'm really not sure how many pacts were signed, but I can recall only agriculture and energy, sir, that uranium pact.
Energy.
Yes,
energy is the major thing.
Yes, sir.
With Vietnam, how many pacts are signed, agreements are signed?
Sir,
I'm Jordan.
Sorry. Oh. Yes, sir. Sir, I'm not sure, sir.
So, what is gunboat diplomacy?
Sorry, sir, I'm not aware of it.
Sir, I will give you an answer later. So what this controversy, some illegal, ill-conceived decision on passport, and later the government withdrew. What was that?
Sir,
the government, central government.
Definitely. Sir, government tried to propose an extra passport for the, like a different kind of passport. Which one was an orange color passport and the blue color passport?
Orange.
Sir, two passports.
Come to the point straight up.
In which it was not notified by the Ministry of External Affairs to other countries, and because of that, a lot of people also got rejected for the visa in Germany recently, sir.
Orange passport is meant for who?
One second, let me recall, sir. Sorry, sir, I forgot about
diplomats are given what color passport?
I think it's maroon or brown color, I'm not sure, sir.
It's burgundy, correct. White is for official passport.
Official is white.
Yes. Not the white, silver, light silver.
Recently, the skull of a soldier was executed by the East India Company for having participated in the Sipai mutiny. It surfaced in the news. What happened?
Sir, I'm sorry, sir, I didn't follow it.
One soldier by name Alam Beg. His head was taken as a souvenir. It was located in London. Okay. But this genetic defects, the insurance should cover.
Yes, sir.
That is the latest talk or the government decision, or Supreme Court has decided.
Yes.
So what do you say about that?
Sir,
based on the genetic defects,
yes, sir,
the insurance should not be stopped.
Yes, sir. This was a recent judgment which was pronounced by the Delhi High Court. I think it's a very welcome judgment because in India we have right to equality, sir, and all persons should be allowed to have that equality in the real sense. And that is why this was extended to people for genetic illness also, because they have not done anything wrong, sir, because it is not their mistake to be born with a genetic illness. I think government has the court has taken a very right decision, sir, because it can serve a lot of people in India, sir.
Say something about the stem cell technology, why it is not getting very popular.
Sir, a stem cell is a cell which is known for its totipotency and pluripotency. That means it has the capability of converting into any cell or any organ with any different function. That is an undifferentiated cell which can be specialized to take any function in the body. I think it's still under research stage. I will not take that argument that it is not developed, because it is a very much developing field, and recently we had China growing up a human ear itself using stem cells. So I think in future we'll be doing a lot of wonders with stem cells.
Is there any collection center?
Yes, sir. In India, a lot of centers are coming up for taking the placental stem cells during delivery, sir, which is happening regularly, sir.
Okay. And even the umbilical cord is also being collected.
Yes, sir.
And if the family wanted to preserve it, you have to pay a fee.
Yes, sir.
You can ask them to preserve it.
Yes, sir.
This what our ancient grandma was doing it. The stem cell, I will talk to you later.
Yes, sir.
We met last year.
Yes, sir.
What happened?
Sir, I didn't clear last year, sir.
So, I asked a question about this organ donation.
Yes, sir.
There are two things. One is voluntarily you are giving your body for research. Now that has been made somewhat simplified now,
yes,
like 10 years back. But those who are injured and those who are going to die, getting the permission from the person's relatives is a Herculean task. Words are inadequate to, you know, describe the situation, to convince the parents or some of the relatives. What do you think the role of the grief counselors in improving the number of organ donations from the people who are accidentally, you know, get into certain things? So can you describe the role of grief counselors, and how many hospitals in Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry are having awareness of grief counselors and also the existence of grief counselors?
So, to answer to the first part of the question about the role of the grief counselors, they play the major role in convincing the relatives
something
of the society.
Something unimaginable.
Definitely,
yes.
Sir. It is
can,
their role.
You can persuade a person to donate his organ, a healthy person, he'll sign it. But at that juncture, getting
yes,
the permission of the
yes,
near and dear ones.
Definitely, sir.
Yes.
Sir. It's a very difficult role because he has to take into account the emotional component of the relatives because they are already in grief also.
Yes.
So I think they play the major role.
Yeah. I'm asking the present status.
Sir,
at what stage is the role of, because sometime in 2000,
yes,
almost 18 years back, Apollo Hospital, one person admitted there with multiple injuries. His organs were given to four people. If my memory correct, it's 5 or 6 people.
Okay.
That time, one doctor told me that the role of grief counselors is very, very important, and Apollo is actually giving impetus to that. So as a man coming from that profession, I'm asking you the role of grief counselors. Is what the government doing is creating awareness is adequate, or what could the government should do, and what should the civil society and others should do? And doctors like you should.
Sir, personally speaking, even I was not aware of the role of grief counselors, because in my institute, only the doctors take care of this responsibility.
So
sir,
there is no post of grief counselors?
Sir, I am not aware of it, sir.
Okay.
So I'm really not able to comment on that.
Okay.
But in your second part,
we'll just find out.
Definitely,
yes,
sir.
Yes. It's actually, you know, very, very small in numbers. There are attempts more made to increase it, but it has not taken any. No, your second choice is the Indian Foreign Service.
Yes,
what is your view on Aung San Suu Kyi in the Rohingya crisis? And recently, the Oxford Students Union has demanded that the Nobel Committee should withdraw its Nobel given to Aung San Suu Kyi. How will you describe this situation? And literally, it's unbelievable for a leader like Aung San Suu Kyi at that stature,
yes, sir,
to behave like this.
Sir, actually, it's definitely unbelievable for me also, because a person like Aung San Suu Kyi, who has been awarded Nobel Prize already for peace, should actually have taken much more measures than she is doing right now, sir. And the one reason which I could see is that, first of all, Myanmar is a very, very young democracy, because up to 2011, it was under army control, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So I think because of internal pressure and internal politics, she has been folded in this quagmire, sir. And because of that only, she is unable to take action.
Is she behaving like this for sheer political vote bank politics? Because that's the conclusion one could arrive.
Sir, definitely, sir. We can definitely arrive at that. And one thing is that because it's a very recent democracy, it takes some time for the democracy to establish itself, sir.
Mm.
So in that phase, the Rohingya crisis has taken up. And but whatever it is, humanity should be the first concern, sir. I think the international community should put pressure on Aung San Suu Kyi and the Myanmar government to consider the pity which the Rohingya people are facing, sir.
We support Government of India's role in accepting the refugees. when it is encountered head on the Supreme Court. And Supreme Court asked, why don't you consider
yes, sir.
Accepting the refugees in liberal mind? The government of India said that India cannot be allowed to be a capital of refugees.
Yes,
how do you do this? Is the government of India's role correct when it says on the one hand that Osuteva Kudumbakam and on the other side they are, is it because of Shia they are Muslims that the government of India is refusing?
Sir, I don't think so. It's the because they are Muslims, they are rejected, sir. The problem is that we are already facing the crisis because of excess migrants coming into the Northeast India, which is already not very stable because of the internal security issues, sir. And we are also having reports that a lot of Rohingyas have allegiance to the terror groups like Al-Qaeda and Islamic State. So these are the two reasons which were cited from the government side. But according to me, India has been the pioneer in humanity, sir, and India should always be the same. And I think, as you already said, Vasudeva Kutumbakam concept, I think India should accept refugees, sir. As
at least a part of it or fully? You know,
sir,
how many, can you quantify how many people are there in that situation, working in the refugees, I'm asking, who are in desperate need of help from any country?
Sorry, sir, I'm not able to quantify, but already we have 40,000 Rohingya refugees in India, sir. That much I'm aware of it, sir.
Mm.
And but I'm not sure how many are still wanting to enter India. But I think it should be an international effort by all the countries surrounding Myanmar, so that if everyone shares the burden, it will be a much better state, sir.
3-4 days back, the Supreme Court judgment on the Kaveri water issue,
yes,
the Chief Justice, they have quoted a Helsinki Convention. What is the Helsinki Convention on water treaties? Why should they quote Helsinki Convention in that
way? I'm sorry, sir. I was not aware of it, sir.
Sir.
Okay. This Rohingya.
Yes, sir.
Bangladesh is making some stopgap arrangement to.
Yes,
what, is, what is that?
Sir, I'm not aware of the island's name, but they have provided an island for Rohingyas to be stationed there, sir.
Okay.
And India is also supporting Bangladeshi government through a project by supplying all these rice and essential commodities.
Okay.
And this is already clear.
For island, they are just
yeah. How many, sir? How many?
All of 40,000, more than 40,000 people have been from the Cox Bazar, Bangladesh. They have been
so temporarily
sheltered.
They were sheltered there.
Yeah.
But recently.
So, and the numbers are something like 400,000 to 500,000
okay.
Totally. Tell me, I'm asking a question not because of anything, because already we have discussed for long, but most of the questions were focused on your space, except for the foreign this thing, and there also why Bangladesh is doing for Rohingyas is a special thing. Why not other countries? But I will ask you economic and this thing. What is the status of the Indian economy, and how did demonetization help or kind of impede?
Sir,
what were the objectives of the demonetization? Not the four reasons, just two reasons.
Yes. So to answer to the first question about the state of Indian economy, I think just 2 days back, the recent CSO estimate said that we are growing at 7.2% GDP. So that shows that we are again getting back to the position of the fastest growing major economy.
Mm.
And we have $4 billion of reserves, which says that we are in
$4 billion.
$400 billion US dollars foreign reserves, which says that we are at a very very comfortable position in the global arena, sir. So, and we have inflation under control, and all these says that our actually Indian economy is in a very good state right now. Coming to your second question regarding the demonetization, the major objective of the government was to tackle black money, but as time went on, government changed its stance, saying that.
No, no, did they achieve that major objective?
Sir, according to the reports, we did not achieve, because 99% of the cash in circulation came back into
come.
The.
So, what did they achieve? Demonetization. They just disrupted the economy, particularly cash economy. Okay, now again you have black currency, black money. So, you did not change the counterfeit currency, which is 60,000 crores has come. So, what did they achieve?
Sir, according to me, the one major thing demonetization has achieved is that fear in the minds of people, sir, that you will be caught if you are having black money.
You need a demonetization to do it?
Sir, I don't say that we need such a major step to do that, but at least it has done that, sir. Ethically, people have that fear right now, at least to not stack money in their banks or in their
sir,
house.
If you permit me to ask one question,
please.
Are you joking?
I mean, to create fear.
So,
like
what
the
name
that you said, dark money in bank. How can you, you post money in your bank? It's a black money.
In international banks, they had said, they had to bring it back again and change
it. Has it come from international banks?
So we don't know.
Do you have any indication to show
indication.
That money has gone out?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
so
you talked about round tripping.
Yes, sir.
So money has gone out and come back.
Yes.
But there is nothing. Anyway. Thank you. I think I just wanted to round up. Yeah,
more
please.
Question. Mm. I would say a statement. You would have to say yes or no and also kind of justify your answer.
Definitely.
It's possible to be a philatelist without owning any stamps. Am I right or wrong?
Mm.
Ma'am, wrong, ma'am. Because philately itself is a hobby of collection of stamps.
Okay.
So, but the objective of philately can be achieved even without collecting, because by visiting a lot of museums you can develop interest in stamps, and you have now the digital sources which you can actually save the stamps as images also, ma'am.
Okay.
So all that
right.
can be done, ma'am.
So which is the stamp in India they printed inverted, which is the costliest stamp in India?
So the inverted stamp I can think of is that the inverted four on a Queen Elizabeth, I think, so that was inverted stamp I can think of.
Which year?
It was somewhere around 1857, I think, so I'm not sure of the exact year, sir, but somewhere around 1850 to 1860, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Just
okay.
give us a minute.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And
thank
you would see, you have to get ready for you are aspiring
that
for
will come, sir. After
2 minutes. Just 2 minutes, you'll come.
At
that time,
thank you.
Thank you, sir.
You come back as you come normally.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank
you. Even if it is the repetition, please knock on the door, walk straight, come and wish as if you are entering for the first time. Wish the lady, wish all of this. Okay? Those are all the basic things. That's what you need to do. Because there is no shortcut, and every smallest of the things do matter. Okay, because those people who are sitting here, they are not against you, they are wanting to support you, but at the same time, they have to filter out. They have to find who is better than all others. That's one thing. So last year you went for the interview. So you had all this domain experience, knowledge and everything. Why do you think that you lost out in the interview?
This time I spoke my mind, that's what I think.
Okay.
That
last time
a big
I had almost like written a lot of questions and had written answers kind of thing. So I was very mechanical in my approach. So I didn't give any examples which I could have done very much better, because that is the natural way of speaking for me. I just had a different way and
very
I was a bit nervous also during my interview.
Very good. Being a little nervous, there is nothing wrong. Everybody will be nervous, you're going, it's going to decide your fate. That's fine. But you understand that this is very important. And we are not looking for correct answers. We are not looking for four causes of so-and-so, two causes of this so-and-so, not like that. It is simply a question of your passion, your interest, and how much you know and how well you know. That is the whole thing. See, first of all, we feel that you have got the proper demeanor, you are decently dressed, you are yourself, and you are able to answer questions confidently. Whatever you know, you can explain. So I think there is no reason why you should not get through. So that is there. So let us be very clear. You also are able to smile slowly, little at least. If not, you can smile a little more. Okay, you don't lose anything. And you are able to engage people. You are able to talk to them. To that extent, it's fair enough. There is no reason why you should not do it. You have the personality to do it. But at the same time, there is one weakness which is major. That is beyond your space. You are not comfortable. If you are asked about foreign policy, if you are asked about economy, if you are asked about something else, if you ask something else, basically I am not sure whether you have read quite a bit or not, or what is lacking. Because you are not specific, you do not know the kind of things, etc. You know, okay, you could answer approximately about this thing, etc. demonetization and things, but you could be much more specific and about the economy, status of the economy. Okay, it's not that great. Only this quarter you have gone to 7.25, whereas for the last 1.5 years your exports were down, your production was down because of GST. This thing was disrupted because of demonetization. Your cash economy was disrupted. All these things happened just because one thing that comes out, you suddenly think the economy is good. And at the same time, you thought that your inflation is under control. If your inflation was under control, why are the banks raising their interest rates? You see, you are not convincing. And you explained so much about your interest in serving the community, doing the whole thing. All that falls flat the moment you say that you were a doctor, you did not serve in the rural area. You have to provide, come out with a kind of a answer which is reasonable and justifiable why you did not do it. Otherwise, despite explaining so beautifully, you will, you know, as to put it in a straight term, it looks like a fake answer, what you're trying to give. So which says, if you're not able to do that, how can you expect others to do this? You understand? That is the basic thing. You understand that you can do it. There is no reason why you cannot do it. You have the ability. And for example, the question that they asked, this Trudeau had come. You know, Trudeau's visit was the 7 days visit. Okay, the difference that happened in that case is that normally they come at normal protocol, they come and meet Modi or whatever it is, and then they go to other things. So then he tweets and then he hugs and whatever the things are, and then the whole thing happens, and then he can go around and do whatever they want. Here in this case, two things happened. One, the Canadian embassy, government wanted it to be at the end. So he was just gallivanting everywhere and anywhere they were going. Second thing, that Jaspal Atwal, who was a convicted criminal, for 20 years he was convicted by the Canadian court for the murder or attempted murder of an Indian MLA, and he was invited to dinner. And they said it was overnight, but then they produced photographs of that fellow with the Trudeau's wife everywhere. So these are the things which are very important. This is the highly controversial visit. If you forget about all Jordan, this, that, and other things, fine. But you cannot forget Trudeau's visit. Highlight what was the thing, why was it, why did it happen? Isn't it? Why did this Modi show cold shoulder to him? You know, he is praising everybody, he welcomes, does everything. But why did he cold shoulder Trudeau? That's very, very important, because he was pro-Khalistani. He attended an event in Canada, Prime Minister, where there was a pro-Khalistani flags and Bindranwala things, etc. He went and made a speech there. These are the specifics. You come out with specific points as to why and what, and that is what earns you something special. Otherwise, if you repeat the same thing for general, you see, what you said, everybody knows. You don't earn the extra points by that. Okay? But your basic demeanor is good. You are able to handle the things, are good. All those things, I think there is not much to do. Don't have to change your personality, but I think you will have to read up quite a bit of it. That's what I feel. Anything
one
else?
Point, sir, this Canadian connection with the Sikhs, it's actually a very interesting topic. You know, over 30 years, when this Khalistani terrorism were at its peak, the role of Canada was very much different. You know, that Kanishka aircraft.
Yes, at the same time. Russia, same time that Kanishka was bombed out.
That Naidu and other scientists were killed. So when you look at that history, I think as of now, I may be wrong, the number one country which is responsible for sheltering so many Khalistani terrorists is not even US or UK, it is Canada.
Canada.
So the remnants are there in Canada, they are much entrenched even now. Otherwise, how could as sir said about a convicted criminal be a part of the Prime Minister's or President's convoy?
And convicted criminal where? In Canadian court?
In Canada itself.
In Canada? And if you go back to the history, when Indian people started migrating to other countries, it was the Sikhs in the Indian army before independence. Sikhs in the Indian army in Malaysia and all, when they left and abandoned, they went to Canada first. Canada was the one country which actually they were able to reach, not even US. From Canada, they came to US. Now, what I'm saying, you see, it is not just generally knowing something. You have to be genuine. You have to know things, whys and whats of it. You understand? When is the interview?
It's March 14th.
14th, you have about 10 days time. So wish you all the best. Go and believe that, as they say, you believe that you are an officer, you are, there is no reason why you should not get it. Because you are no less than anybody else. That's the attitude with which you should go. Not overconfident and arrogant, but why should you not get it? You should. But to do that, they won't simply give it to you, you have to earn it. To do that, you will have to study, go with the attitude, and then go on. Wish you all the best. Anything else?
No, I think I'm just
fine. Yeah. If you have any questions, we ask.
Do newspaper reading a lot?
Other than Hindu?
You may be asked, where is the Prime Minister today? Who are the dignitaries today? That day's paper you go through.
You must read that. And what is the economic paper you read? So you should read an economic paper. You must read an economic paper. Either Economic Times or the Business Standard, any one of them. You must read an economic paper. And that, as I said, on that day of the interview, irrespective of what time you get up, what time you run, you whatever it is, you must read the newspaper and go. You should know the headlines.
Go with an idea, where is the Prime Minister that day? Who are the dignitaries in the country that day? Like that.
What the headlines? Basically, you should know what is happening. Okay, internally and externally, what are the important things? Okay, wish you all the best. Right.
All the best.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And when you say that, say it confidently, wish them each one and then go. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay.
Actually, you said you can just walk in normally. You said. That's why.
No, no. Walk in normally as you enter. You understand?
Normally,
in the sense, how are you normal? This, I didn't say walk in casually. Isn't it? Okay.
On the board, if you find a woman member, first
with them.
First with them. And the others later.
I get all the privileges.
Yeah.
In this context.
You know, that has to be like that. That's the basic etiquette.
How much was the last interview?
No, now you should get good. Okay?
Okay.
But
you realized it.
But must read upon it. You can't, you know. You may be good at your subject, but you should also have some more information. Okay? All the best.
All the best.